Lisa posted in the posted on her blog, "Here a mook, there a mook."
Oh yeah, that was kind of interesting. I got some interesting response to that, and we still got some discussions going on the groups, on the Google groups and other places about defining a MOOC. Now there's one going on in the Facebook group too. It's kind of interesting the way people are latching onto that as a subject.
And when I read your post, I was thinking, and it reminds me of what, when we were talking about this early on, and we've kind of talked about this every week in some form or another. Vance was always saying, massive doesn't, it doesn't have to be massive MOOC. It can be, what did you say, minute?
Minute or minuscule, I call it
Minuscule.
minuscule. I
And
mean,
I was thinking,
yeah.
after reading Lisa's post, something like SOOL, Scalable Open Online Learning, because
Oh, I like that.
I think the key ingredient is that is the ooh, the open and online part, and the fact that it
Well,
can be whatever size and scale, and the course, like, this doesn't feel like it was a course. It feels like it was a learning unit of some kind, but I don't, it doesn't feel course-like to me.
yeah, the only thing that really makes this a course is the defined topics for each week. And so yeah, we've talked about SOOCs, small open online classes and that kind of thing. So I'm not sure how much the massive matters, but if it has been the model, with George and Steven doing these, for them to be hugely massive, and so that's what a MOOC is like. But when I complained about that in my post and said that, little MOOCs like the one I'm offering for professional development don't get noticed, Stephen Downs immediately put it in the daily, and I've been watching my analytics ever since to find out just how massive ours is going to become, because we're not really ready for that.
The massive is very important to Dave Cormier, he makes a point, that it's got to have the it's the critical mass. There has to be a critical mass in order for the real in order where you have this kind of MOOC where there's little facilitation, nothing would happen if it weren't a MOOC, if it weren't massive. I mean, if you're doing that with 12 or 24 people, things might not be very interactive. So I guess the massive has to be there if you want that kind of thing. But you can take apart from that, apart from I mean, you can run it on a small scale and still use the other affordances, still benefit from the other affordances, I think. So that's my point on the minuscule. You can run it. You can run your course as if there were a lot of people there, and apart from the critical mass of interaction, you're going to get the other values from it.
I guess it depends a lot on whether or not it's using a connectivist pedagogy or not, which has come up several times in the discussions of MOOCs, because if you're using a connectivist pedagogy, then a larger group is really much better. But if you're using something that's a little more guided or a little more organized or a little more topic-oriented, I think the smaller format works just fine. And then people can lurk or join or whatever as they wish. But the core group is smaller.
And you seem to indicate in your blog post that one reason that people are concerned with the name is for research purposes. And I suppose that's tied to this week eight topic of what's ahead in the world of online learning. Do you feel like, well, if we can crank out some piece of research that proves the utility of MOOCs, that this will change something?
Well, I think there's a big reform thing going on that's tied into MOOCs, that the idea is that MOOCs are going to change the whole idea of education by taking it out of the universities and places where the focus is on credit, is on getting the credit, and instead try to focus on the learning. And I think that's a very laudable goal, but whether the MOOCs themselves are going to actually change the model, I'm not really sure. But certainly in the meantime, while they're working on it, a lot of people are using them for research, and I think we'll see even more of that. And I'm not sure the extent to which that's in support of the reform, but so far everybody who's doing the research that I've seen are clearly people who want to reform the entire educational system and make it change in a very big way, and are using their research to on MOOCs to try to promote that.
So MOOCs, by definition or by practice, don't have any kind of assessment or quantifiable output component?
Well, that's part of the argument, I think, isn't that? Is Osvaldo was here? Is he?
He's popped in and out.
I keep getting a notice that says he's here, but I don't see him. Oh, okay, because he was talking about the Stanford artificial intelligence class and saying that, you know, their assessments are automatic. You know, their assessments are clearly going to be multiple choice and that sort of thing, and automatically graded, and therefore it's not doing what it's for.
Excellent timing, Osvaldo. We were just bringing you up in conversation.
Oh, yeah, I was just talking about what the testing. We were talking a little bit about assessment and whether the extent to which an assessment is significant in a MOOC and the extent to which, well, who controls assessment in a MOOC, because the artificial intelligence course from Stanford with its 48,000 people or whatever it is clearly going to be, the assessments are clearly going to be based on something that is computer graded or is self-monitoring or something like that. And how important is some sort of assessment that is where somebody's work is graded from by somebody else from the outside? Or how important is the connectivist pedagogy and assessment in looking at a MOOC and saying whether it's effective or not?
See, I think they have three things going on there. I mean, there are 58,000 people. You know, probably of that, maybe 1,000 are going to be participating. And a few of those will be taking the course for credit. And some of those will possibly try to get the badge, you know, the congratulatory note at the end that says you've made it. So they'll have to take the test to get that. But Vanessa Vail makes a really nice point. She's just asking, you know, what if the other participants just take over? You know, what if they just, the professors aren't really going to be there for all those many people, so they can just talk amongst themselves, and then it would be a MOOC. Think that might happen?
Depends how they set it up. I mean, you can make a course where nobody sees each other, and that was my question from the beginning. You know, you just let the people one too many, and you don't know who are the other 58,000 or 1,000 people hanging around, so you don't have a way. I mean, if there is no Google list or there is, I mean, you can set up something just being your own and 58,000 people hearing on the other side, right?
Yeah, I think people, I mean, you know, people are going to find each other. You know, if you, you take, say, of those other two categories I mentioned, that's probably only 50 or 60 people, or maybe 160. But, you know, those other 1,000 people are going to find each other.
What do we know about the structure of the Stanford course? How are they going to, what kind of stream of content is there going to be? What's their main interface?
According to the article, they said they're going to put polls up where students or participants will vote on questions to ask the moderators, and the moderators will answer the questions. So that's how they perceive their interaction. But I kind of agree with Vanessa. I think a lot of people aren't going to play that game. It's up to them, you know. I mean, it's just a course that they'll be at, so they might as well interact together. I think I tend to do that. That's what I've been doing with EduMOOC pretty much exclusively. Interacting here and then a few selected blog posts and my Scoop It and that sort of thing.
Well, that brings up an interesting point, because to what extent should the people who are facilitating the MOOC be the ones in charge of creating the network? Because the network that's being created for this EduMOOC with the live presentations, as we've noted, there's not a whole lot of opportunity there to participate compared to here, where there's tons of opportunity to participate. I'm here instead of there because the lack of opportunity to participate in that discussion, I found the whole hashtag Twitter thing as the back channel to be very tedious. So if the instructor is, if we're reliant on the instructor to set up the network among the students? I mean, is that required for it to be a real MOOC? Do they have to be in charge of saying, well, here's how all you students contact each other? Or is it still a MOOC if the students do that, as you say, Vance, they do it independently, and they're going to find each other anyway? So to me, that seems to be more part of the connectivist idea anyhow, is that the students hook up with each other regardless of what the professors are doing.
Yes, that's fine, but I think if you create a course, if you create a company, if you create a family, you have a responsibility, or you don't create it. And then you have like this MOOC, like EduMOOC, which is totally on its own. And you see the dropout rate. We started with 2,000 people interested. 1,500 really are in the Google list. And today, 40 people are looking at the web page, and 10 people, five we are now, are doing something together. So I would qualify this as a MOOC, but I would call it a bad MOOC.
And we are up to six now. Hello, Rowan. Ooh. Hello, goodbye.
I participated in another MOOC, two other MOOCs, and there the cooperation and interactions were really high, and in this one it's just going floating on its own. I mean, you don't even get an update from the organizers on the blogs, and the presentations are live, but really it's the same as if they were taped. So it's a MOOC. The question is, at the very end, everybody will say, is this a good or a bad MOOC? Is this a good or a bad course? It depends on each one. I think as a MOOC, having massive, it's a bad MOOC. As a way of getting together with people like I'm doing with you, it's a very good MOOC for me. But not massive.
There you are.
I mean, you have to put all the words there if you want to call it a book. So that's my point.
I do want to say hello to our newcomer. Hello, Rowan.
Hi. Hi. Sorry.
Am I pronouncing your name correctly?
So I disappeared a sec.
Do you just want to tell us a little bit who you are, where you are? Are you involved in the EduMOOC at all?
I have been with EduMOOC from the beginning, but I can't say I've been involved. I'm a corporate librarian. I do intellectual property research, so I'm not really in the demographic of, you know, academic stuff. But I'm interested in distance learning and how we're delivering information to people, so I thought I would join the MOOC.
Great. Welcome.
Thanks.
I do have a comment on what Oswaldo said, if I may. I'm wondering whether it's incumbent upon the organizer of a MOOC to create a course in the sense of having to engage all the aspects of the course, student interaction, content presentation, and everything, or whether what the facilitator is creating is really more of a space. Is it enough? Is it a MOOC if the instructor is creating a space and some content and a means to communicate, rather than creating every single element of what we would traditionally call a course?
I think so. I don't think, you know, considering, I mean, you get what you pay for, and we enjoy the interaction. You know, we're here because someone said, okay, let's have a MOOC. So it's kind of like a party. Some parties are better than others. Some parties are better facilitated than others. But basically, it's the people who show up that make it. And also, if it happens to be at a right time, then you'll benefit more than if it's not at a good time. Because for me, sometimes, depending on some of the other MOOCs that go on, they're right in the middle of when I've got classes and things like that. So even though the facilitators are sending out summaries and all that, it really increases my guilt because I don't read them, you know, because I just don't have time. So, I mean, I'm very happily muddling through this one and, you know, unaware of all I'm missing, as usual, but still benefiting from what I am participating in.
The thing is, in my interest is to try to put this kind of format in other aspects, in other subjects, like for example this artificial intelligence. For people in Argentina, it's going to be very, very good because you can hear the best teachers from, say, in this case, robotics. I think they're not better in the world, or they could be comparatively equal. Free of charge, you have a course, you can access it, you can work on it, and that's very, very good. So I really am very, very much interested that the MOOC is good. In the case of education, where we can talk, with opinions, and it's totally different when you do something scientific. I mean, when you do science, when you do maths, it has to be very strict, it has to have a course, it has to have a structure. And then, of course, if it becomes connectivism or if it's a MOOC, then people have to get together and start doing things together, which is the new aspect. The other one is just doing an online course for everybody.
Yeah, then you're sort of expecting that kind of course, a science, you know, to give you something top down that is, you know, I mean, if it were an introductory chemistry course, probably that would be reasonable. I think for this one, I don't know. They said there you need some maths and things like that, so you need some skills in order to understand the course. With all those people, though, there must be some who will be there who won't have the skills to accept the top-down, so they might just socially discuss what they're getting from it, you know. So there must be, like, because it's another tenet of MOOCs is that, as George Seaman says over and over again, you don't know why people are participating in your course, and that's what a MOOC accommodates. You know, I mean, a top-down course is addressed at one common denominator sort of student, and the MOOC accommodates people who are there for no matter what reason.
I'm curious where we think this is headed. I mean, you mentioned that the Stanford course is going to do some kind of assessment. What does that count for? What do the learners get as a result of that? And as universities are looking at MOOCs, how are they thinking of integrating it into their commercial and educational validity flow? You know, how are they going to use it in a way that serves their needs? Like right now, it seems like mostly it's a cool experiment, and let's see how many people we can get in our MOOC, and yes, we're part of this big social, open, networky thing, but how do MOOCs serve universities' needs?
Maybe Stanford will be able to start something like, you know, over 1 billion served.
Yeah.
You know, maybe it's partly outreach, you know, saying, you know, look, you all think we're an elite, closed, expensive university, but look what we're doing. We're doing a social service. And I know that with companies, being able to show that they're doing a social service helps raise their stock price. And education is fighting right now in a social sense for relevance, and perhaps it's part of that.
Yeah, I think they're redefining the educational model, you know, and bringing it in line with the 21st century. I think they're probably benefiting just from experimenting. I mean, if they're truly academic, then that's what you're supposed to do. You're supposed to learn things, and this is how you learn, by setting up such courses, I suppose. You know, I mean, that's the benefit from someone who puts it on. That person is going to learn quite a lot. And you learn a lot about learning and what motivates people to learn. Because if you're giving courses to people who are enrolled in a degree program, then of course a lot of what they take is because they have to. Whereas if you take students, if you get 50,000 students, okay, not so many, but anyway, if you get some students there who want to be there, then that's a completely different motivation for taking a course. Like Osvaldo, for example, he's in Argentina and is going to benefit from getting something that he wouldn't have access to.
And we're getting the echo again, Osvaldo. Did you have any thoughts on how universities might actually integrate this into their educational models and business models? And how is this going to be just sort of an ongoing experiment to say, hey, we're part of this 21st century open content thing? Or in 10 years, are there going to be MOOCs that are part of 4-credit for-profit education?
Well, I've been sitting back thinking about the idea that what a MOOC allows you to do is come in and get what you want or need from it. And because, you know, that AI course, my understanding is the math is quite significant, that there would be few people who would have the level of math that you'd need for that Stanford course. But, you know, I think that people will show up and get what they want or need out of it. And there's something really attractive about that. And, you know, Vance was talking about the motivation. And, yeah, I don't know. If we could take down the barrier of, well, you might fail this course, so you better not try it. You know, if we take down that barrier and just say, well, you know, if you're interested, give it a try and see where it goes. And, you know, maybe it'll take you a couple times of actually showing up and doing it. So take statistics, for instance. You know, I had a person in my class last fall who had taken it. This was her third time through. And she always did pretty well. But she said, you know, every time I, like, learn something new. And, you know, she was able to say, well, you know, this time I understand this like I've never understood it before. And there's, you know, something to be said for that. You know, taking it once, maybe getting a little something, and then taking it again if you're still interested and trying to understand it better, and taking it again, and, you know, and letting people just do that. I don't know.
That rings true to me. That seems like a path toward being part of a MOOC and integrating it into how universities have to function. I can see sort of different paths through a MOOC. If you just want to participate and be part of the conversation, that's an option. If you want to take it the next step and say, oh no, I want to take these assessment challenges and I'm willing to pay some money and get some credit, that's an option that's included in the MOOC.
Yeah, and I've heard people talk about, you know, you pay at the end. So you do all the work up front, and then if you're interested in getting credit, you pay and you do whatever's left to get the credit, whatever that would be. And we could redesign the way that works. So it's not about, you know, your grade. It's less about how much you participate and all those little pointage things all along the way. It's some sort of assessment of what you know at the end or can do or something like that. So.
Yeah, for me, the excitement is what these people are going to offer. They're very intelligent. They're going to use Amazon as a way of broadcasting and doing all this because they're going to have so much people. They will bring new tools, which most probably we've never seen how to. I mean, they are artificial intelligence. They can process the questions. They can do, I mean, things that are beyond, you know, people who just use whatever is there. They're going to improve, and I think that's where we're heading. I mean, we're heading to a university which will be global, a university or education that will be global, and this is what we're learning. And I think that Stanford takes it, or at least this technical people who know a lot, they're going to contribute in expanding the possibilities and ways of evaluating and how people may or not interact. That's something to be seen in that part. So I'm very excited about it, and I think it's going to be a very, very good course. So I'm waiting to get the orders of, actually I'm contacting them to see if I can study on the side how things are going, but this is another part. And before I forget, I sent a survey, because we had this open educational resources university group, which unfortunately died out. So I managed to make a survey, because I didn't have the means with SurveyMonkey. So 10 questions, very brief. So at least I would like to see 3-6 people doing it. So you're invited. So I will check. I don't have a way of checking, but if I get less than 6, I think I will be bad. I will be sad.
Do you have a link for that?
I just sent an email to EduMOOC. You should
okay.
See it. A few minutes before we started this session. It's in SurveyMonkey. It's very brief, so it should be fine. We'll see what the response is, because I'm really amazed that there's still 100 people hanging around looking at the web page. And you don't see them active. We talked about this last week, Jeff. And in the live session, there are something like 300 people hanging. So, and now you saw that someone started again about this artificial intelligence. And new people came out this week from Facebook, actually, and it's responses. And so suddenly, I mean, the lurkers call it, or the people that are, I mean, everybody's looking. And if they find something interesting, pop, they pop up, and you get a group of 10, 15 people for a few days doing some work together, which I think is very good, very interesting.
Yeah, I think this yeah, MOOC, I don't know about the other ones you've participated in, but this one, they're really starting to ruminate over the concept of the MOOC. And I just put a link to one of George Siemens' talks, and I've done some transcription of some of what he said there. And one of the quotes there, he says, the formal learning process is irrelevant to meaningful learning. But what's even better, I think, is this thing where he says, if you listen to it and go to 1 minute and 13 seconds, he says, have you ever thought about how completely irrelevant structured learning is? That's a really radical thing to say. And, you know, and he goes on to explain it in a very interesting way, why he's so interested in this kind of learning, you know, which is which is reaching students where they're coming from, you know, because and making sure that the teacher stays out of, the teacher doesn't say, walk this path, this is the path I walked, you walk the path too. The teacher is forcing the learner to find the path. In that talk, he talks about chaos, you know, how learning is chaotic. Or, well, yeah, learning, it comes from chaos. From chaos, we make order. You know, if it's not really chaos, it's fractal, you know, it's Mandelbrot, you know. So there's actually a pattern there, we just have to discern it. And that's what learning, that's the richest kind of learning. So if you have students who can do that kind of learning, like us, for example, then learning will take place, you know. And I think I think that's why this concept is taking off at Stanford, for example, because people are really interested in exploring. It's really taking off. You know, there's a poverty and No Child Left Behind and that kind of thing. You know, so this is possibly an anecdote to it. So,
okay, I think it depends on the subject. When I studied physics. Actually, I'm a theoretical physicist. All my research has been on that, except in the last years where I've moved to education, and this is my interest now. And I saw a guy in my physics class, he's now a very good physicist. He never attended a lecture. He never attended a lecture, and he just came in for the problems, just made them, and he went away. Did he have a structure? Yes, he had a structure. You see, he had a structure which was, someone gave him a program and told him where the books were. So he went to the books. He didn't need the teacher. He didn't need the learner. He just read the book. And someone told him what to read, because if not, it's infinite. And he came, gave the exams, and he had all 10s. And so depends on the subject. There are subjects where, but you always need, in science, you always need a structure. You need the structure of seeing what's there before. You don't need so much the interaction, or some people don't need so much the interaction between them. Some people do. So then these are the two facets, the two extremes. Up to now, the MOOCs have concentrated on educators and things where you can talk on things on the theory of education and whatever, and this is very ample. In science, things are more restricted. So I want to see all kinds of MOOCs or massive courses or courses, how they develop and new tools and whatever. So. That's my opinion in this case. You always need a structure.
I'm sorry to interject. I just want to say a quick goodbye to Vance. And Vance, do you want to plug anything for this week's Learning Together?
Learning Together? Oh, we're in the Moodle Moot this week. It just started. In fact, when you Skyped me earlier, it had just started. So there's a Moodle Moot going on. And you can find all this at Learning Together. I'm putting the schedule there, learningtogether.pbworks.com. I'll slip that in the chat before I go. And so on Sunday, I'm giving the talk. And the talk, actually, you can see the talk. I'll put also the link to my presentation. I've got an early version of it now. I've finished the presentation, but it's in the slideshare.net. It's really about MOOCs, so that's what I'm talking about on Sunday at 1300 GMT at the Moodle Moot conference. So I'll put some links in the chat as I'm slipping out. And maybe I'll see you on Sunday.
As always, a pleasure. Take care.
Yeah. Okay, bye-bye.
I'd like to get back to Osvaldo's point about the subject being a big issue, because the MOOCs that have happened so far that have been called MOOCs are all focusing on educational technology and the internet and what we're doing here to where we sit around and talk about what's MOOC. And of course, I offered or tried to offer a history MOOC that utterly failed, that absolutely nobody from the outside came in, regardless of it being advertised on various social networks. And Dave Cormier, you know, had said to me at the time that the reason he wasn't coming is he already took that class. So it indicates to me that right now the whole MOOC field seems to be pretty self-referential and is very much tied in with talking about education itself and the future of education and the structure of courses and how much structure is needed. The interesting thing about the Stanford course will be that it's at a higher level, it's a specific subject, it's related to some of this internet stuff, but it's not focused on it. So it'll be good to watch it just for that reason. It's on an academic subject.
Whereas the Change MOOC is going to be another one of these kind of meta MOOC experiences where it's all about online learning and changes in education, right?
Exactly, which is great, you know, fantastically useful for people like me who are into this kind of thing and are trying to make sense of all of it while we're doing it. You know, kind of learning while doing. But for people from who are interested in MOOCs in particular subjects, this is really not what they're looking for. And I'm curious to see in the future, since we're talking about the future, how that's going to develop. We talk about these things as if they're going to be offered in all these various subjects and people are going to have to worry about what credit they're going to get in this kind of course. But so far, I haven't seen a MOOC offered in an academic subject.
Well, that's interesting.
That's interesting.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
No, after you.
All right. Just, you know, back to Osvaldo's idea of structure, I've watched quite a number of youth, like teenager-type ages, go about learning very, very subject-y courses in very unconventional ways. So they haven't really taken any courses. They might have taken a course, but it was not, you know, they were just sort of, so like they would watch the MIT, you know, OpenCourseWare course for something in particular, and then they would go over here and they would read this thing, and then they would go over there and look at that, and they would chat with these people on this forum about this particular thing. And I've seen it happen in at least sort of a programming, so someone who learned programming and sort of how computers work, and, you know, so that one seems obvious because a lot of that work happens online, and so there's all these forums and everything. And so the other person I've seen that I can think of very specifically learned math that way, and I just find that pretty stunning. As far as I know, he's never taken a math course, and yet he did quite well on the math section of the SAT, so he clearly learned it. I'm not exactly sure how. You know, and I would just hear his mom say, well, he ran to the library and got an algebra book out because he felt like he needed to learn algebra. And so he did some algebra work. And then he did some other places, and he's very, he gets into not really finances, but he's very interested in money and the stock market and things like that. So I think he probably read a lot about, like, all the numbers that are used in stock market stuff and what they mean and how they're calculated and things, and he just like figured it all out, and no one got in his way. And in the other case, you know, as well. And I just wonder, you know, if we had more opportunity, we maybe we're not seeing it because people don't have the opportunity to learn this way. If you know what I mean, like we get in there too much with courses and say, you know, take this and work through it this way, and take this and work through it this way. We keep putting that out there, and if we just put out the ideas of how you could learn this and let people learn it in their own way, I wonder if we would see something very different.
But it doesn't sound like he needed anybody to tell him the path. This is an independent learner who figured out how to do it. He doesn't need a course at all. And if you set up a MOOC in math, he wouldn't come.
Or I wonder, in a MOOC context, could people kind of find other people whose paths are similar, you know, could he have clustered with other people who are like, yeah, I'm into stocks too, or whatever.
Yeah, and I suspect he probably did cluster with those people. I just don't know it. I certainly saw the kid who learned about computers cluster with people like crazy. There was tons of clustering. They were making Teen Linux things that are like the Teen Mac site, and so they were clustering like crazy. And so it may be that the other boy did as well. But the idea is that there is some structure to the materials already. So he went to the library and got an algebra book. The algebra book is pretty structured. It lays it all out, just as Oswaldo talks about the guy. Anyway, as the physics, you know, the boy who learned physics, he just worked down that textbook.
Let me put up a slightly different subject, which I put to Dave Cormier in the first Hangout, which we had. I think it was number one, Jeff. I put up the following. There are two companies which I'm following, which started actually open, so they didn't charge. But then they found out that they wouldn't work. They needed some money. And one is from Berlin, and the other one, I don't know from where, but it's called Babel. And there you learn languages. And they charge you $3. So I would say it's kind of open. It's less than the $150 for the book of artificial intelligence. But it's massive in the sense that thousands of people are hanging out there, and they have, you put yourself inside there, and you start with lessons that they prepared, very, very well done, and with a lot of multimedia things, videos and whatever. And what they do is they offer you to contact anybody that is in your same level anywhere in the world doing a course similar, following the course again. So you contact someone in Italy, and she corrects your speech. You talk to that, I mean, you make groups like these hangouts of 10, 20 people, and you start learning together the same language, but the other one knows your language, and you teach them your language, and you correct her papers and things like that. Would you consider that a MOOC? Or is it interesting? Because, for example, countries like ours, people don't speak English, and of course that's they don't enjoy or they don't profit so much from the internet, although there is a Spanish, branch, which is very, very big, because Spain and all these Spanish-speaking countries do a lot of these things in education or whatever, but they miss the other half, which should surely, in some ways, is more advanced. So there is a need to make a massive learning of the English language for many in Argentina. The question is, you can do it freely if, let's say, a university or someone, state, decides to do it in this kind of way, in the way that you enter, and not only you have a course structured, but you also have this possibility of people communicating with themselves, correcting themselves, making groups and whatever. Would that be in the MOOC idea, would you think, or is it totally different?
You know, I see a MOOC as a subset of something bigger. You know, whether you call it scalable open online learning or massive informal learning experience, you know, all these things are happening, and a MOOC is, okay, one part of that definition, but all that other stuff is still happening with variations and different forms.
Yes, what is interesting now is that the word has spread out. You say MOOC to the press, and you see it in the New York Times, actually. Although they don't speak of a MOOC in the New York Times article, they do speak in another article, comparing it to a MOOC. In the New York Times, they speak of a massive course, but they don't speak as a MOOC. So to destroy the word MOOC, now there's been so much marketing, it's like saying, I won't call Coca-Cola the Coca-Cola anymore, and I think that's not good. So I think MOOC, but the massive word, that M, is something that, you know, it's a kind of nice thing, because it attracts the media, it attracts people interest. But suddenly, smaller groups, I think we talked with Lisa, we communicated on this last week, 50 for me would be a fantastic number. And even 30 people or 20 or 15 people gathering together and getting together to do some activity from anywhere in the world, global. And I think that's, I mean, it's still in the MOOC philosophy from my point of view. You wouldn't get so much interactions, you wouldn't get so much things like perhaps you would dream if you have more people, but I think still it's very, very positive.
That's interesting that you said philosophy, because it makes me think, well, maybe MOOC is more a philosophy than a structure. I keep thinking of it as a structure. But maybe there's a completely different way to look at it.
And I'm not especially attached to this word MOOC. I think in 10 years, it's going to be like edupunk or some other word that's sort of, it's got some buzz for a while. I don't think we're going to define what's really happening here as a MOOC specifically. I think it's a stage of development in open online learning.
Well, if it's what's popular, I mean, if the New York Times is picking it up and is using the word, then its advantage is just that people may understand what all of us have been doing for the last 4 years. Because I don't think that's generally understood. And although certain people at universities might be innovators and might be early adopters and might be saying, no, all we have to do is open this class to everybody and we've got something different. I mean, maybe the term itself can just help people who haven't been with this all along understand what's going on.
I think it needs to be a better word, like mile or smile. Add an S. Make it a smile course. Rowan, I just wanted to check in with you. Any thoughts on any of this?
I think the only thing that we might... there was this discussion with David Wiley at the beginning of EduMOOC, not because it was within EduMOOC, but at that time when we started EduMOOC. I don't know if you followed it. And it was a big discussion what a MOOC is, and David Wiley has his ideas. And I think it comes what Jeff says. It's really online, open online education. Not necessarily massive, not necessarily connectivism, perhaps, but it's something that's happening, that's going and floating around. And there has to be some preparedness of the people that are attending the MOOC or the course. That preparedness is, or they are so intelligent that they don't need any preparedness, which is just a few people. Or they need, especially in these technical issues, technical courses, you cannot start just by discussing with each other and saying, oh, we hang out together and, you know, the more the merrier, we'll solve all the math problems. It's going to be, you know, every week, exercises, doing this, there, and having a lot of probability and knowing logic, ifs and if nots and things like that. And that will take the course, and there will be very little time for the other stuff that we're doing here. So, coming back, I think David Wiley had a point, and I'm trying to see what the point is, and this is, I think it will evolve on its own when other courses of more, he was claiming that there should be some math course trying to imitate the MOOC and see how the idea of connectivism could be done on that, and he suggested that it would be impossible. And I agree in a way on that, partially. Okay, I don't know what you think of that.
I find it interesting that you mentioned time and that there isn't enough time. Maybe if the course is too structured and everybody's being led along the same path and is reading the same book, this is what we're doing with the online teaching certificate class, is there's activities that are assigned for every week and people have to do them. How much time will be left over for them to communicate with each other in informal channels? I think if you think of a course as structured by a certain amount of time you spend on it, perhaps our expectations are structured by formal education, and that if you feel like you're spending blah blah hours a week on doing readings and doing tasks that are assigned every week, that you don't have time left over to bring in the social aspect. That kind of thinking may be guiding how people participate and choose to participate in these open courses.
What if we call it a cool course, collaborative open online learning course? Because I think the collaboration is actually a key ingredient to what makes a MOOC successful. It can be open and it can be online, but it's when people start working together that I think a MOOC is considered successful or not. And I still feel like course is sort of an optional thing too, so I'm sorry.
But how structured does that collaboration need to be? I mean, is it because, like, in the course that I've designed for the online teaching class, the collaboration is sort of built in. In other words, there's not necessarily a structure for freeform collaboration or set off in this particular direction. It's built into the structure of the class, which is sort of designed like Jim Groom's DS-106 course. So that stuff is going to happen. Collaboration may happen, but there's a certain amount of it built in already. So where is the focus there on with the word collaboration?
Well, I would think there's a spectrum. I mean, here there was very little structure, but collaboration happened. You had people working on the wiki page. You had people using study groups for a while. You've had us hanging out once a week. So without structure, we figured out how to collaborate, or you could formalize it more.
So the collaboration is not necessarily with the intention of producing an end product. I mean, it is with the Wikipedia page, of course, but when we're hanging out here, we have leadership, that's you, but we aren't collaborating in order to create something necessarily except discussion and analysis itself.
I concur.
Yes, but you do have always the possibility that it happens. Like, for example, in the, Moby book, seven of us, we don't know each other. I mean, three people in the US, then you have someone in Canada, someone in Turkey, myself in Argentina, someone from Brussels, no, from Belgium. And we wrote three papers together. How it happened, it started like this hangout, and suddenly clicked, and now we're working on the side, you know, doing research and collaborating. So the nice thing is not that it's happening perhaps today, but if I find that, I don't know, Jeff's interest close to mine, most probably will send him an email and we start collaborating. And this is the global and beautiful thing. It's like this thing I told about the languages, right?
And I mean, I would consider this sort of a flow. I'm sorry, can I ask you to mute Osvaldo? George Siemens posted a couple weeks ago about how there's no there to social media, and that these kind of flow activities aren't as meaty as blogs and journal articles and things. And I see a lot of this collaboration being kind of flow activities, but if they're archived, then the collaboration produces something. You know, we've had no defined output for these webcasts, but you can go to YouTube or listen to the archive.org, and our audio is there, and we've got list of links we've shared. So I don't think it has to be anything other than what's produced by the time spent learning and collaborating together in a flow way.
And I wonder, yeah, but also I clearly learned a lot by just doing this. This is the fourth one of them, maybe the first one, I forget. So this is maybe my third, the first one being just getting technically competent. And so does there have to be an actual product? You know, the collaboration clearly has, you know, I've learned a lot. Like, I've never been in a MOOC before. I didn't really understand what it was. Just hearing you all talk about, you know, the previous ones, how long it's been going on and things, it's just been, I've learned a lot. So I wonder if that's the point of collaboration, is for each of us to learn something. There's no output.
I need to leave. It's 12 o'clock, so I have some something to do. It's been a pleasure meeting all of you, and most probably I'll see you in the Stanford course or change, and we can get together again.
Sounds great. It was great to connect with you.
Bye-bye. Sounds great. It was great to connect with you. Thank you for your time.
Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.
So Rowan, I did want to get back to you. We haven't heard from Rowan in quite a while, and I'm just wondering what you're thinking of all this blah, blah, blah. Collaborative blah, blah, blah.
Collaborative blah, 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 yes. I'm really interested. It's really far from what I do. I wish I had heard about the history MOOC, because that sounds like something I would have gone to. but I'm interested in how people get together to learn, but I'm also interested in these examples of the very self-motivated people, the young people who, you know, take out the algebra book. I think they're a really small part of the population. I don't know whether that's because of the way that we structured learning in the past, and that if you started earlier, but I think that some people, maybe a lot of people, are just take the easiest path, whatever that may be, and you know, can lead a horse to water, but you can't necessarily make him drink.
And I'm curious, I see in your Google Plus profile that you're a gamer and a virtual world enthusiast. Do you see any convergence between this kind of open online learning and the world, the virtual world and gaming? Like, can you imagine a learning virtual environment or a game structure that, okay, let's get 1,000 people in world and focus on history? You know, I can imagine all sorts of things like that.
I have done a lot of stuff with education in Second Life. I'm, you know, was involved in the Information Island, the library archipelago of people trying to deliver information in Second Life. And I've been to a lot of courses in Second Life myself, and collaboration with other genealogists, for example, on, you know, doing our family history stuff, all kinds of things. I think there's definitely, I've also participated in some of those wild gaming things where we all get together to try to solve the world's problems and the structure of a game. I mean, I think these are really exciting areas. But so far, for me, I have so much life. I don't have time. I mean, the weekly, I went to the first couple of weekly things, but they start at like 10:30 and go through my lunch hour or something. And so it's a really awkward time to make. And so even though I'm interested, I'm having a real hard time being an actual participant. And I get the Google group
digest.
And it's like, you know, 8 pages long. I'm like, ah, too long, didn't read. Information overload. On the other hand, things like he mentioned the language learning. I've done some live MOCA stuff. I think it's really good for that, where you're talking to other learners or native speakers in the language you're interested in learning. And I don't think live MOCA has quite built the level of collaboration. I think I'm really interested now in the idea of whether there are any Google Hangouts for language learners, because I think that has a lot of promise. But so there's just some wild, you know, brain musings, but I don't have any great contribution to make. Thanks for asking, though.
Well, thanks for sharing. And we are coming up to about an hour here, so I think it's almost time to start playing Pomp and Circumstance as we walk down the aisle. Any graduation thoughts?
I really appreciated these hangouts. I don't think I would have connected really otherwise. So this has been really good for me. Thank you.
It's been wonderful for getting me thinking about things. I have pages of notes just from chatting in the two I've participated in, and it's been very cool, Jeff. I really appreciate this.
And thank you. I've really enjoyed hanging out with a bunch of smart people, and kind of an eclectic crew each week. And I don't know what's going to happen with this kind of thing. You know, there's going to be a MOOC going on all the time. So, and you know, I'm part of EdTech Talk and EdTech Weekly, and we're not quite sure we're ready to transform the show somehow. So one way or another, I'll be webcasting, talking about ed tech in some way. But thank you all very much. It's been a great great learning, great open online learning experience.